appreciate the Taylors, Brother Taylor's help, his contributions to our effort to know the Lord. So that's what we're all about. That's what we're all about, is to know the Lord. That's the first, primary, and biggest reason we come Sunday after Sunday, is to know the Lord, know the Lord, know the Son of God. It's not enough just to be religious and acknowledge God, acknowledge deity, acknowledge the Creator. That's good. We should do that. But it all centers on the Son. The whole plan, the whole faith is focused on the Son, the Redeemer, the salvation. Remember that. There's a lot of good people in our world who pray to the Creator, who pray to the deity that made it all, and acknowledge that there is a deity. But remember something, the deity has a plan. The deity has a plan for the salvation of mankind. The plan is the Son of God, the giving of his life, the payment by his blood for salvation, redemption for humanity. That's the whole plan right there. So, you do well to acknowledge God the Creator. You do better to acknowledge God the Creator and the plan of salvation in his Son. That's how you get your name in the book. We talked about that in our last Bible study. Is your name in the book? We have a song. We haven't sung it for a long time, but probably in the books. Is your name written there? Is your name written there on the page bright and fair? In the book of all ages, is your name written there? Amen. God has a plan. The plan is Jesus Christ the Word. The plan is Jesus Christ the Word, who gave his life, shed his blood, and rose again to defeat death and Satan. That's the plan. It's got to be a complete plan. You've got to have the whole plan, folks. It's not enough just to acknowledge the Creator. A lot of people stop there. And that's good to acknowledge the Creator, but remember something. The Creator has a plan. A plan of salvation, redemption, payment, new life, eternal life. It's the whole plan, folks. Praise the Lord. In your Bibles, in the Gospel of Matthew, we want to speak for a while with this idea, with this thought, getting the most out of religion, getting the most out of religion. Let's have a word of prayer to begin. Thank you, Lord, for this good day. Thank you for the spirit of worship, of prayer, of praise, of seeking that is upon us today. Praise your name. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for each individual that is here before us and with us, Lord. We're glad for each one. We have hungry hearts. Hungry minds, needy lives, all of us. And we're looking for that, for help from you today for that. And then, Lord, there's some that are not with us. God, from our number today, be with them where they are. Watch over each one. Protect them. Speak to them. Give them the power and help on this Sabbath day wherever they are. And in all things we give thanks and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Brother Dietz and I have been working on a little plan to have a series of meetings here in the month of March, just for something extra, something from outside our midst. And we've been talking to Brother Becker to come and minister to us. Sometimes it's good for us to hear from other sources about the work of God, the plan of God, the challenge of the Lord. So we're working on a meeting in March, working on it would be more like a long weekend. Thursday through Sunday, or Friday through Sunday. So we'll be talking about it, but we'll be talking to you about it as well. But you remember to pray about that. Meetings in March for us here. March, middle of March, maybe a little later, but somewhere in the mid-March. You can help us pray about that, okay? Yeah, Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. Pick up our reading there at verse 1, Matthew 5, verse 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Let's stop reading there. So, we often call this the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes. But in the sixth verse is the verse we want to think about here for a little bit. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. They shall be filled. You read a lot of these, and they are a blessing, but they're also a promise. There's also fulfillment at the end of these. Let's say it like this. If you do this right, you'll be satisfied. Just like if you eat the right food, you'll get filled. Now, you can get filled with water, but it kind of doesn't satisfy your hunger, does it? Yeah, it does fill your belly, but it doesn't quite meet the need. So, Lord, help us to understand getting the most out of our religion, getting the most out of our faith, getting the most out of our efforts to know and understand spiritually. You've got to get something out of this and take it home and think about it, even if it's just one thought. Take one thought home and think about it. If all you get is a word that made sense to you that day in the context of the Word of God, take it home and feed on it, work on it, think on it, dwell on it. Get something out of it. Church will just be another weekly activity if you don't get past the surface functions. If you don't get past the surface functions. You know, we used to go to a buffet in Nevada. We enjoyed it. It was really just pretty big. Lots of salads. Lots of entrees, lots of additional stuff, and lots of desserts, and lots of beverages. My word, you could go in there. If you come out of there hungry, it's your fault. You come out of there hungry. My dad, he loved to eat crab legs. So when we were done in there, boy, there's crab legs everywhere where he was sitting. Yes, crab legs sticking out all over. Well, if you know about crab legs, it looks worse than it actually is. There's a lot of leg there, but not a lot of meat, you know. But boy, he'd really tie into it and get his fill. Back in those days, I used to get a lot of shrimp. I like shrimp. You can't do shrimp anymore. Found out I was allergic to them. Anyway, we used to eat shrimp, and boy, they'd be roasted. It was our fault if we went out of there hungry. It was our fault if we went in there and just drank water. It was our fault if we just went in there and ate an onion and left the rest of it. It's your fault if you don't get something out of the religious effort you make. There's got to be purpose in this whole thing, and you got to go home with something. You got to go home with your belly full, right. In a sense, in a spiritual sense. You've got to make this thing work. You've got to go deeper to get what it is. If you just came for the surface activities, that's all you're going to get. That'll be good because the food's usually good. We've got tremendous cooks in our midst, so you will go away feeling good that way. If you got a few friends in the group, you'll go home feeling good that you met your friends and got to fellowship some. But if you're interested in spiritual and eternal, then that's going to be up to you to dig it out and get a hold of something and take it home and think about it. You say, boy, some of that stuff, it takes me all week to think on it. Good. Good. Good for you. That's what you want. Years ago, our children were visiting one of the grandparents. And this grandparent says to our children, says, oh, you want some jerky? Beef jerky? Or whatever she thought it was. One of her grandmas. And so she handed out the beef jerky, and kids were chewing on it, and they said, boy, this don't taste right. Oh, my, this don't taste good. They chewed on it for a while, then started pitching it, I think. Well, when they checked on it later, Grandma had mistakenly given them dog
treats.
Grandma had mistakenly given them a dog stick. Something, you know, for the puppies to chew on. It wasn't jerky to eat. They chewed on it a bit, and it didn't seem right, so I think they got rid of it. It wasn't going to work. It was fake food. Wrong food, wrong stuff. Wasn't going to meet the need, wasn't even tasting good. You remember that, okay? You remember that. When you come to church, get something more than just the surface of things. It might look good and sound good, but get something more. Take home something that challenges you. Take home something that even makes you a little bit mad. If it makes you mad, you know, maybe there's a sore spot there or something. That might be saying it's strong, you may not be mad, but you may kind of think about it. Wonder if I'm like that. Wonder if I'm like that. Wonder if I have that kind of attitude. Wonder if wonder if I'm kind of the problem. I wonder if I'm a little bit of the problem. Go home and think about it. Think beyond the surface. Church will just be another wiggly activity if you don't get past the service functions, surface functions. This has to have deeper meaning if you ever get out of what the Lord intended for the fellowship of the faith. It's going to have deeper meaning. Deeper meaning is your responsibility to tie into. Now, my wife, ever since she, I think our fourth child, she developed a condition. And the doctors told her it's going to be a problem for you as you get older. And so she took it serious. And she said, all right, we're going to change some things. Well, she didn't just change it for her, it changed all of us, because she's the main cook. She's the main dietitian in our family. And so the adjustments she made affected all of us. Well, the problems the doctor said she was going to have, that was about 21 years ago. She didn't get them. She took the word seriously and then looked for a way to deal with the issue, the problem. Amen. It's up to you. It's up to you to look for and find the deeper meaning in the faith and not just settle for surface. I'll tell you what, we spent a good while talking about some of the deeper issues in Sunday school today. Aaron didn't get a chance to dwell on some of the later things because we spent a lot of time hacking away at understanding some of these matters. That's what you want to do, is get down into the warp and the woof of our need, of your need, and make this mean more to you. Make it mean more to you. What events in your life have deeper meaning and emotion than just the food and games? What events in your life have deeper meaning and emotion than just the food and games? Is there any functions like that? Well, we had five occasions that we took serious in our lives. Of course, the birth of your children is a serious occasion. You take that pretty serious. And whenever they get sick, boy, you really get down to business and give attention. But there was another event that had meaning for us. That was the dedication of the babies. The dedication of the babies. You know, we never really understood fully what all that would really mean. But we understood it enough to know that that's what we wanted to do. That's what I want to do. That's what we want to do. That's what we're going to do. So we had our babies dedicated to the Lord when they were still too young to know what was going on. They're just still babies, little babies. I think we had our, I'm not sure who done it, but I think maybe one of the grandpas might have done it, the kids. And then we were out on a journey when baby, the baby of the family. So we were at the minister's place that was the chairman of our board for some years. So we had Brother Sankey dedicate our youngest child. Amen. But now, as time has gone by and we've watched and listened and observed the hand of the Lord in our lives, you know, we're glad it means something. It meant something then, it means more now. Those events. Other events, what do they mean? What do they mean to you beyond? Well, there's a lot of events. Graduations meant something. When the kids graduated, when the boys finished their boot camp training in the Marine Corps, we went down there. What a great occasion that was. Man, they were skinny as reeds. Boot camp took everything extra off of those bodies. Man, they were just... But to watch the performance as they marched in and marched around and did the things they did, just tremendous. That had a lot of meaning. Deeper than just circumstance, because we knew what was going to come out of that. It meant more because we knew the day would come when they would have to go to a faraway place and put their life on the line. So, while we were celebrating, on the one hand, we were also deeply, deeply remorseful and pain at a deeper level because we understood the meaning of that graduation. Yeah. What events in your life have deeper meaning that others would not, it would not mean the same thing to you? You could go to that Marine graduation as a friend and have all the feeling you have. But when the time came and you had to finally say that goodbye and they're going across the sea to the war zone, then you really understand the significance as the parent. See, you have those kind of events. What kind of events in your life have deeper meaning? Why do they have a deeper meaning? What is it about it that gives you that sense of deep feeling? A friend of ours was riding with another friend. They were on the highway in Oklahoma. And as they were riding down the highway, they got to a certain place on the highway where the driver broke down into tears, just slowed down, even stopped, and broke down into tears. And his friend was in the passenger side observing and looking around. There was nothing significant about the location on the highway. If you've ever been to Oklahoma, Oklahoma is like this. Wide open. Northern Texas and Oklahoma are just tabletop. Little hills here again. There wasn't anything significant right there, but the driver finally, when he was able to stop his sobbing and deep feeling, he said, "This is the spot where his dear friend, who was a highway patrolman, was hit and killed when he was on duty." That spot, that event had great significance because he was a dear friend. So whenever they would go past there, it was meaning that went deeper than just what it looked like, than just pavement, than just prayer, than just brush, fences, gravel. There was deep meaning there. Amen. Is the faith like that to you? Is the faith like that to you, that there's a deeper meaning and emotion in all of this than just the surface stuff we do? We've got to get there. We've got to get there to where we begin to get that sense that dealing with God and God dealing with us has a deeper meaning and a deeper power. Help us, Lord. What events in your life have deeper meaning and emotion than just the food and games? What memorial means more to you than all the other stones around? bunch of other rocks in that place too. A lot of other stones in that place, scattered for acres. A lot of stones. But this one stone has more significance than all the other stones. Well, we don't go there very often. Once in a while we'll go there. Yeah. Why is that? That's where my wife's dad was laid to rest. In 1984. Well, that's kind of a long time ago, isn't it? 94, 04, 14, 37 years. Or 33 years, whatever it is. 44 years. That's a life. Shouldn't you be over that by now? Shouldn't you be done with that by now? You know, it has a deeper meaning.
That's right.
It has a deeper meaning. It's more than just stone. It represents something more. Amen. Listen, our faith has got to get to a place to where it represents something deeper for you, folks. Amen. I was thinking about this message while I was working on it and thinking on the thoughts and the feelings. I said, Lord, you got to help me see something here. You've got to help me understand what I'm talking about here. But the Lord showed me. He showed me something real interesting about the faith. About the faith in me. And about the change that He had done within me. What had ceased to be and what changed and transpired. And when I understood that and saw that, I knew there was something powerful here. I knew there was something more. I already knew that, but all it just took on, the Lord blessed it to me as a deeper meaning of being saved. I know better why it means so much now. When something means a lot to you, you don't give it up easily or at all. My wife will go to that stone off and on in her life with the same depth of meaning. She'll never let go to that deep-seated affection. Ever. Amen. You've got places like that in your life. You've got things in your life. You've got situations where it'll never go away. It'll always be there. Yeah. And if the faith, if Christ Jesus, the Word, doesn't become that to you, it'll be easy to just kind of leave off and go another belief system. Go another way of thinking. What memorial means more to you than all the other stones around? Why is that? Some connection at a deeper level is why that. Some connection at a deeper level. The deeper level connection is personal. That's why. It's personal. That's why if we make the faith like this, it's not just because Joe is here and Josh is here and Patty's here and Paul's here and Becky's here. That's when I feel good at all. That's not like that. It's something personal. And that something personal translates into a we are together in this. But if all of you gave it up, if all of you gave it up, would you still stay with it? Well, let me tell you something. It wasn't any one of you that was responsible for the deliverance that I had back in 1973. None of you were responsible for that. None of you really had anything to do with that. It was in Jesus' name. In the power of Christ. The deliverance that the Lord gave me. It was deeply personal. Amen. Still stands. It still stands. So why do you stay in this? A lot of people don't even like this. Well, a lot of people were not responsible for the deliverance that I had.
That's right.
In the name of Christ. In the name of Christ. Nobody here is responsible for that. Nobody out there in that church is responsible for that. Nobody out there. Well, there was a few, I think, that prayed. Thank the Lord for that. But it's deeply personal. Salvation, the faith, must become deeply personal if you're going to get past the surface issues. The deeper level connection is personal. Understand that. So, you're here with a personal belief and faith and walk and love life in Christ Jesus at whatever level it is. Whatever level it is. And it's up to you to make it personal. And the more you do that, the more it'll mean to you. The more it will mean to you. If a faith is something personal, it's going to mean more to you than just a bunch of other rocks around. It's going to mean more to you.
That's right.
At the deepest level of faith is a desire to be good. Why is that? Because God is good. Pure and simple. God is good. We sing a chorus sometimes, God is so good. God is so good, God is so good, He's so good to me. God is good. At the deepest level of faith is a desire to be good. Desire to be good. You know, when you think about it like that, to take a verse like this, blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Why? Do we want changes in government, in cities, reservations, towns, counties, communities, families, cousins and their families, siblings and their families? Why do we want to see changes? Why? We have a desire for good. There's a deep level desire for good. For good to prevail, for good to be the conqueror, for good to be dominant, for good to prevail. A desire for good. Why? Because at the deepest level of faith, where Christ should be, because God is good. God is good. Amen. That's not deep, hard stuff to understand. It's really pretty simple, but it's very profound as well. At the deepest level of faith is a desire to be good. Because God is good. And to be connected to God means I want good. So, you say, yeah, but I don't like him. I don't like her. That's your problem. It's up to you to deal with that. It's up to you to get to the place to where you want good for that person. Amen. That's more the issue there, folks. It's not a matter of we have to be holding hands and be in fellowship and doing things together all the time and be all that. That's not the defining issue. The defining issue is, at the deeper level, do you want good for them? There are people of faith that I don't hang out with. Contradicting yourself. Listen to me. I don't hang out with them. Why is that? Why is that? Why is that? Because we have too much baggage. We have too much conflict. It's more peaceful to not hang out together. So, what do you feel inside? I want good for you. That sounds contradictory. No, it's not. It's not. We have this mistaken notion that we're just going to be all lovey-dovey about all the faith and everybody. everybody in it and everybody that's ever been in conflict along it. It's going to all be love. It ain't going to be that way. But what it is going to be is you're going to want good for them.
That's right.
Even if you can't hang out together, you're going to want good for them. You've got to search your heart on this one, folks. If you're a child of God, you're going to make a few enemies. If you're a pastor, you're going to make more enemies. If you're in charge of a lot of people, you're going to make a whole bunch of enemies. That's nothing new. That's nothing profound. That's just the way it is. But at the core of your being, if you have a good God, then you're going to want good wherever. Amen. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. For what? They shall be filled. Yeah. As much as some people disgust me, I just search my heart and say, well, Lord, help them anyway. Help them. Help them, Lord. I'm not going to celebrate with them, but I do want to be good for them. How do you feel? How do you feel about it? How about the ones that really disgust you to umpteen end? You just know in your heart you'll never hang out with them ever. But how do you feel about them? Do you want good for them? Amen. You say, yeah, I want good for them, but I can't say I'm hungry and thirsty for them to be overwhelmed, but they might blessed. Well, that's okay. That's honesty. That's honesty that needs a little work. Amen. You know, sometimes us holiness preachers, we preach an idealism that is unworkable, undoable. Amen. Well, help us. Now, I can tell by the look on your faces, you're going to go home and think about it. Praise the Lord again. That's all we want. Amen. But at the deepest level of faith is the desire to be good, the desire to want good, because God is good, and to be connected with God means I must be good. And I must want good. Amen. I mean, in marriage, you're not always lovey-dovey. You get to really where you're really disgusted with one another. At times. No, not at times. At lots of times. Really disgusting. But, you know, there's those times when we finally got to a place to where we started to understand how this was working, and we just decided to be friends. Well, we're having a hard time really getting an understanding, but I'm still going to treat you good. I'm still going to look out for you. Yeah. I'm still going to laugh. We're going to be friends. Even if we can't be lovers at this point, we're going to be friends. Why is that? Why do you want that? Because you want good. At the deepest level of your being, you want good. And one day, maybe, we'll make a step over the threshold. And we'll be back again to a more intimate sense of union. Amen. You say, do conflicts get that severe? You know they do. You know they do. James knows they do. Lee knows they do. Janet was married. She knows they do. Bill knows they do. Gene knows they do. Aaron knows it does get that way. Melissa, you know it gets that way. Darla, Clint, Suzanne, Jane, Mary, Frank. Except Janelle. No, she knows it. And Joe. John, Patty, Paul, Becky, Eddie, Jim. It gets that way. But do you hunger and thirst for righteousness? You want good. in your conflicts. You want good because God is good. And if you love God, He's at the core of your being. And you're not going to let it go easily. It's going to be more than surface. And you know why you're sitting here praising God? Because at the deepest core of your being is God. And a love for Him and a desire for Him. And you want good. And so you can't do it all. You just reach out and desire good anyway. Well, I had to make some big changes to get to the place to where I could want good for my enemies. I know my kids probably think, oh boy, after all the stuff I've heard Dad say, I don't know how I could ever feel that way. Well, I confess, I had to get past that. I had to get to the place to where I could want good for somebody. Like I said, I'm not going to hang out with them. We're not going to hang out together, but I can want good for them. Amen. You know, I've seldom recovered relationships that were in big conflict to be what they were. Holiness preachers often give you the impression that you got to do that if you're really sanctified. Well, let me tell you something. Really sanctified, but some things will just never take. But you might as well get at the deepest level of your being a good God that makes you hunger and thirst for good, and you begin to want good for those. You want them to be safe. You want them to be healthy. You want them to prosper. You want them to do okay. You'll probably never hang out together with them. But you still want good for them. Praise the Lord. But I realize I can't do it on my own. I need help.
Yes.
That's probably one of the biggest realizations you'll ever have. I can't do it on my own. Well, I'll tell you something. Early on in marriage, well, I had to say, oh man, this woman's taller than me. I don't know if my ego can handle that. But I wanted what I wanted, and I said, listen, Shorty, you're going to get in there anyway. You're going to make this work. You know what I realized? This woman had a whole bunch of ability and qualities and characteristics that have been hugely to my advantage. If I can't get in that cupboard, it doesn't matter. My sweetheart can get in there. If I can get in there. And if she can't open that stuck lid, don't worry. Bulldog can do it. I can get it. And if she's feeling bad, I can be there to lift. And often I felt bad. Just didn't know what to do. I'm kind of an idealist type person. When it's high, it's really high. And when it's low, it's really low. But she learned to work with that and decided, well, it's not against me. It's just the way this guy is. Pension, bring him up. Something, anything. Just a kind word, tussle my hair. Whatever. I can't do it on my own. It's what I finally realized in a big way. To be spiritual, to be good, to love the Lord, to hunger and thirst for righteousness, you can't do it by yourself. You can't do it alone. You got to get to the place to where you say, I need help. Hunger and thirst is an attitude which comes out in action. The action that comes out, if you want the help that you can get, one, give reverence and give praise. Reverence and praise. Reverence and praise. Reverence and praise. You want your friends to quit doing things for you? Stop being thankful. Stop praising them. That's right. Stop thanking them and stop praising them. You'll find out pretty soon, boy, that waterfall of blessings is going to dwindle down to a trickle. And one day just dry up completely. And they're gone. Get ungrateful. And your blessings will dry up. When you realize you need help, when you want a hunger and thirst attitude, hunger and thirst must come out in action. The action must be reverence and praise, which puts deeper meaning in our services, our prayer times, our worship, our fellowship. It puts a deeper meaning when there's reverence and praise. We work to teach our children this.
Yes.
To teach them reverence. They don't learn it on their own. Children will not learn reverence on their own. They won't. Children learn reverence from dads and moms and aunts and uncles and grandpas and grandmas who help them to understand reverence. Reverence, reverence, reverence. That's how we learn. That's how I learned it. Man, I see pictures of us when we were kids and Dad was trying to do ministry, me and other guys. We were up there laying on the altar, you know, and just eating candy, laying on the altar, rolling all over and playing. Boy, that wasn't very reverent, I know. Eventually, Dad and Mom learned what reverence was, and that stuff stopped. It stopped. And the more they learned, the quieter we became. The more they learned, the less rowdy we became in church. The more they learned, the more respectful we became of elders, ministers, men and women. The more we learn, but reverence, it's learned. We learn that. We learn reverence. And when you start to practice that, you'll find it creates atmosphere, attitude, mood, and a better sense of meaning.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Those of you that have a heritage in a church of any kind of long life, and you go to a camp meeting that's a part of that church, boy, there's an attitude there that's different from any other place you've ever been. Yeah. I've been to a few places like that. An action which comes from an attitude. The attitude is, I hunger and thirst for righteousness. Reverence and praise. Last, hunger and thirst, attitudes which comes out in action is connection and sharing with others. Connection and sharing with others. I heard Brother Price one time say this about the word blessed. He said, you can take the word blessed and say happy. Happy. Happy are they which hunger and thirst for righteousness. Why is that? For they shall be filled. Not with dog biscuits. They'll be filled with a good God who meets deep down needs, who gives a sense of hope and strength and courage and love and good, who gives a desire for good within us. It goes out to others. Praise the Lord. Connection and sharing with others. Well, blessed, happy are you. Are you sharing with others? Connecting. You working on it? Are you working on reverence? Praise? You say, yeah, well, a little bit. Good. Well, you got something to go home and think about. Work on it. Think on it.
Amen.
Do you want good? For the ones you know don't like you? You really want good for them? You say, well, I got to work on that. Well, at least you're there, that part. You can work on it. You say, I'm not very good at that. We don't usually start very good there. You say, well, how long is it going to take? How long is it going to take to get there where I really want good for my enemies? So it'll probably take a while. You say, well, that's not encouraging. You got to start somewhere. Amen. You know how far it is? Winter, South Dakota, from here, about 900. chafe about that trip, or you can start out and go the first mile. And keep going, you get there. You can get from there to here in about 16 hours. How do you know that? I used to do it all the time. I traveled so much, I could tell you how far it was from one city to the next, in miles, and how many hours it would take to get there and be right on. Sometimes within a minute. 1,000-mile journey, 800-mile journey, I've done it enough times where I knew exactly how long it takes to get from there to here at this speed limit with the amount of stops you're going to make. Now that's nothing amazing, it's just that I did it so many times. When you do it so many times, you start to get good at it. And it starts to come naturally. And it starts to go deeper. And it starts to be powerful for you and for others. Until finally others are realizing, hey, I can do this thing. I can do this thing. I can lift others. I can help others. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Let's get it done. Blessed. Happy are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, or they shall be filled. Praise God. Let's bow and pray. Thank you, Jesus, for the day that you've given us. Thank you for each one of these blessed individuals before us. Bless them now with your presence, your power, your strength, and your help. Help us this day. Be with those that aren't with us today. Watch over them, protect them. Help us, Lord, to digest the word. In all things we give thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.